G'day, Chris here, and welcome back to Clickspring. One of the most surprising things about the Antikythera mechanism is that such a mechanical wonder could have even been created with the tool technology of the day. I briefly touched on one aspect of that tool technology, workholding, in episode 2. And I'd like to talk a bit more about that in this video, as I make a version of the device that I described. It's basically what we would today call a stitching pony. Two arms carry a simple set of jaws at the top, and the whole structure could be either fixed to a base to sit on, or as I intend to use it, pushed firmly against the bench. A shallow wedge acts as a spacer for the two jaws, and a basic bronze casting can be slid up and down the taper to apply or remove the clamping pressure. Much like the modern equivalent, an ancient version might have had the jaws covered in leather, to both protect the work and also improve the grip on the workpiece. Now, of course, I'm using modern tools to make it, but it's easy to imagine how this could have been constructed with the known tools of the day. The materials are common enough, and for the most part, I'm using interference fits and a wedge to hold everything together, so there's no modern fastener tech required. I must admit though, it's very pleasant to be able to use power tools to get the job done faster. Okay, so as I go about making the sand mould for the bronze casting, I'd like to go through the approach that I'm going to take with the construction of some of the tools indicated in the wreckage of the mechanism. The first thing to mention is that in the case of workholding, for example, it's entirely possible that a much more complex device was used. Grape presses are known to have existed at the time, using a similar concept to the modern machine screw. So it's not a huge leap to imagine a simple wooden screw vise existing in the same period. But as tempting as it is to imagine the ancient Greeks using tech closer to our own to solve the same problems, I think it's worthwhile establishing that this need not necessarily have been the case. The Antikythera mechanism is an elegant and strikingly efficient design. Much the same could be said of the broader classical Greek culture. I think it's reasonable to assume that the ancient Greeks would have approached their tool design in a similar way. They may not have used a version of a stitching pony, for example, but I do think that they would have been strongly inclined towards using something elegantly simple, and here's why. Firstly, the worker was almost certainly the tool builder, so it seems logical to me that the tool design would have been straightforward, making the tool quick and cheap to build from locally sourced materials. Secondly, each tool was a solution to a specific problem, so I'd expect the tools to be practical and functional with no unnecessary embellishment, just a simple design that gets the job done. And thirdly, the worker was almost certainly the tool repairer, so the tool would need to be easy to repair when it inevitably breaks or wears out. So I would expect no unnecessarily complex tech and as few moving parts as possible. As I speculate on the tool technology going forward, this will be the approach that I take with the tool design. If something simple could have done the job, then I'm going to assume that that was the route taken. I'm going to take a similar approach when sourcing the raw materials for the tools. I've made these copper ingots in an open-face sand mould using scrap copper. And the tin is also scrap, left over from making the tin lapping discs in a previous video. The casting looks to be okay, and now needs to have the sprue and riser cut off and be given a general cleanup. I used a file to knock off the sharp edges, and I've left the other surfaces with a bit of a rough as-cast look to give the tool a bit more of an authentic presence. Okay, so next up is the main body of the tool, and for materials I've decided to use oak. It's a nice springy wood and also very pleasant to work. The jaw arms will experience a significant force when they're wedged apart. To oppose that force, I used a simple twine, tightly bound around the perimeter of the two pieces of wood. The twine also serves the purpose of keeping the casting in its operating position, just below the start of the taper. A shallow timber wedge was slotted in between the two jaw arms and then hammered home. I used candle wax as a simple lubricant for the dowels, tapped them into place, and then sanded them flush. Now, there were quite a few traditional adhesives available for use in the ancient world. Although I imagine that a good choice to hold the leather in place would have been something simple like pine pitch, a thick tarry substance. I don't have a lot of pine trees in my part of the world, but what I do have is shellac resin, which behaves in a similar way. Much like pine pitch, it solidifies glass hard at room temperature, but under a low flame, it melts and becomes an excellent glue. In fact, watch and clockmakers have been using shellac in this way for centuries to hold parts onto the face of the so-called wax chuck in a lathe. With the main body of the tool complete, I cut it to a convenient operating length and then pinned the base with a single dowel. Now, I'm not so sure that a finish was necessarily a high priority for an ancient working hard to make a living on the tools, but I figure if it was, then a natural linseed oil would probably be one of the choices available. Okay, so that's the tool complete, and I have to say it has a nice convenient feel. It's easy to position and move about, and it's also easily operated with normal hand strength. It's got an excellent grip on the part, and in that regard at least, it's clearly working. But of course, the only way to really decide if it's a useful tool is to use it to make something genuine, like a wheel from the mechanism. Initially, I'd expected to have to permanently fix the vise to the bench somehow, but I quickly realised that it just wasn't necessary. A small amount of knee or foot pressure is enough to keep it in place. In fact, in a lot of ways, keeping the vise free makes it more versatile. It can be flipped and turned to reposition the work even faster than my modern vise, and it's certainly at least as rigid. This is a very satisfying tool to use. It has a nice flex, and it feels great under the hands. It also satisfies what I would consider to be the two critical requirements of such a tool: continuous access to the perimeter of the work and fast, easy repositioning. So to me at least, it's an entirely plausible option. Now, to be clear, I'm not saying that this is definitely how the ancient Greeks approached the problem of workholding. These are just my personal thoughts based on what's required by this specific machine. But I do think this sort of approach is worth pursuing, and I think it'll shake out some really interesting ideas and conversations as I build more of the tools. And who knows, it may even lead to a few surprises. Thanks for watching. I'll see you later. Now before you go, and while I'm still talking about workholding, in the very first Patron Series project, I made this terrific little hand vise. I think it's an indispensable tool for any home shop. So if you'd like to maybe build one for yourself, and at the same time help me to make more videos, then consider becoming a Clickspring patron. As a patron, you get immediate access to the 5 videos from this hand vise build series, free plans for the project, and you also get access to the first few episodes of the Byzantine sundial calendar build, with more episodes to follow as it's completed. The added bonus, of course, is that one lucky patron will get to keep that sundial calendar at the conclusion of the build. Visit patreon.com/clickspring to find out more. Thanks again for watching. I'll catch you on the next video.